If you queue up the next speaker, I'll introduce him. We have I'll call you an end user. I know your company, Haldor Topsoe is a Danish company that makes high performance catalysts. And Dharmender Singhal, we have you on video now, is going to share his experience with his company's transformation to a digital world. Based on your experiences of the company's location in India. If your microphone is working and your presentation is ready to go, then it's all yours, Dharmender.
Thank you, David. But yeah, can you see my screen now?
Yes, got it now.
Thank you, David. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I feel honored and privileged to be part of this August gathering. This is a different experience because I cannot see my audience. I would like to thank ARC team for providing me an opportunity to share my experience about digital transformation. This is about me. So I am instrumentation and control graduate, and then I'm also a functional safety certified engineer by TÜV. I started my career in year 1996, so I am having around 24 years of experience. And in Haldor Topsoe, I took different responsibility. Today I am heading digitalization and automation department in Haldor Topsoe. So in my session, I'll be focusing on different terminology around digital transformation, also some global trends, barriers of digital transformation, and experience from our company, how to overcome these barriers. I'll also be briefly touching upon COVID pandemic and acceleration to digitalization. So David, you already mentioned about our company, but our company was established in 1940 by Dr. Haldor Topsoe. We are market leader in heterogeneous catalysis for the refinery and chemical industry for more than 80 years. We are around 2,300 employees operating from 15 countries. Our headquarters is in Copenhagen, Denmark. We have catalyst production facilities in Denmark and in Houston. And you can say this is unique about our company. We spend around 8% of our revenue for R&D activities. In this picture, you can see Dr. Haldor Topsoe with Niels Bohr on their way to Geneva to participate in the 1958 UN International Conference on the Peaceful Use of Atomic Energy. We are Sorry, what happened? Can you still see the screens? Hello?
Yes,
Yes,
yes.
we are seeing the screen. Please go ahead.
Okay, something wrong has happened. Just a minute. Because my presentation, I cannot see it.
You can maybe exit presentation mode and go back into it. But we see your screen. We see the slide with Niels Bohr on his way to Geneva.
Okay. Yeah. So sorry for the interruption. So our mission is driven by our passion for science. We contribute to a profitable and sustainable future for our customer, their businesses, and their communities. We help our customer to get the most out of their processes and the products, using the least possible energy and resources in most responsible way. you know, as world's population is growing and average wealth is increasing, people will need more of the things what our customer supplies. So there is an increasing demand of products and services which is happening. But at the same time, natural resources are becoming increasingly precious, and our customer will need to ensure that they can find a renewable alternative or operate using a few natural resources as possible. So there is an increasing constraint on natural resources. And at the same time, regulations to protect our climate, health and welfare again becoming increasingly stringent, and our customers will need to ensure that they do not harm while creating a more prosperous and sustainable future for their communities and the planet. So we manufacture catalyst, and catalyst is involved in 90% of all industrial production. And catalysis made it possible to turn a variety of resources into important necessary product quickly, efficiently, and with a minimum of energy waste. The importance of catalysis to the industry, the environment, and our everyday life is huge. With the help of catalysis, an ammonia plant can typically produce around 2,000 ton a day. And without catalysis, it would take maybe a million days to produce the similar amount. As I mentioned in the beginning, we do 8% of our revenue on research. So we invest in fundamental research. We have around 300 plus world-class scientists, and we collaborate more than 20 universities worldwide for fundamental research, catalyst characterization, catalyst formulation, process development, process impact study, equipment development, and scale up studies, you can say. We have an integrated approach to optimize performance, realizing the energy synergy of science and engineering to our customer. So we start our deliveries with process design engineering and licensing. Then we produce high performance catalyst. We also supply a proprietary hardware, or you can say the critical hardware, which are the most critical item for the performance of the chemical plants. And once a plant is up and running, then we do technical services, where we also help our client to revamp the plant or to do the capacity augmentation throughout the life cycle of the plant. This is about Halda Topsoe, but now coming to the main topic of today's presentation, which is digital transformation. Sometimes I think what is a big deal when we are talking about digitalization? We are learning these zeros and ones from our childhood. So why it is so much of big hype? But to understand that, it is very important to understand these three terms, what you can see on my screen. First is digitization. So digitization is basically moving to digital platform. I remember during my college days, we were learning machine drawings, and we were drawing on big drawing boards. Like, it used to be a very big board, and we were using pencils and rulers to draw the drawing. But now everything is happening in CAD tools. So I really doubt that anyone is drawing utilizing the drawing boards. So this is what is about digitization. Next comes the digitalization. And this is a process which is integrating business with operations. You can say more of a integrated approach. The focus in digitalization is on data-driven approach. But when we are talking about digitalization, in my experience, it is still hitting your bottom line, or it is a bottom line focus approach. But now it is becoming a little bigger deal because when we are moving to digitalization, so here comes out some real organization constraints into picture. Maturity of digitalization leads to a digital transformation, where new business models are explored and true transformation is happening. So the use of digital technologies are changing business models and providing new revenue and value generating opportunity. And this is where you can say top line is shifting. I've also shown an industry term of digital transformation in this slide. Just to show some trends, so leaders of Fortune 500 companies, they believe that digital transformation is the future of their business. According to Forbes Insight, half of senior executives worldwide, when asked about digital transformation, said that next 2 years will be critical for their organization in order to make this transition and prepare for future opportunities. Uh, 2020 connectivity benchmark report, it indicated that 90% of organization felt that their revenue will be negatively impacted if their company's digital transformation initiatives aren't successful. And around 96% of the organizations are undertaking digital transformation initiatives in less than 2 years, 2 years of time. This is a picture of Denmark's host computer, Dask, which was built with, you can see, you know, with tubes and walls, and it was equipped with a large cooling system. So the reason of showing this picture to you all is also to emphasize that digitization is not new in Hallertopsoe. We started carrying our calculations of the relationship between design of converters and their efficiency by using Dask in year 1961. But you know, in 1961, there were not efficient IT infrastructure available. So input for calculations were delivered to this computer by telex code, and output were either picked by a company chauffeur or sent by a taxi. And in general, calculation using Dask became a fixed procedure in Hallertopsoe work with converters and other projects and equipment requiring large calculations. We were pioneer. Hallertopsoe was pioneer in the use of computers in the design and operation of ammonia factories and other chemical factories. Topsoe acquired its IBM system in 1968. You can see this was also the article which is published in one of the book which indicates same. But when we acquired these computer services, we offered a broad array of services, including supplying programs for the designing of converters, heaters, and of various system, as well as you know, complete loop. So, like as I explained about our you know, history of our company and also like when we started. So we were really digitizing our processes since 1961, and from 1968 we took a different journey. But our journey of digital transformation started a couple of years year back. We are still not mature. This is definitely not a straight path, and I'll be sharing some of our experience from this journey. again emphasizing on what we did to overcome some of the challenges. I can surely say that barrier to entry level has Hello. Can you still hear me?
You're back. You were gone for about 10 seconds. We hear you again.
Okay. So, David, where were it lost? Maybe I can go back.
Yeah, please.
Okay. So, yeah. So, we were digitizing our processes since 1968, and our journey for digital transformation started a couple of years back. We are still not mature, and this is definitely not a straight path. And I'll be sharing our experience from this journey, emphasizing on what we did to overcome some of the challenges. And I have divided my presentation into four segments, or you can say four buckets. I can surely say that barriers to entry has significantly reduced for the digital transformation nowadays. When I was explaining about our company, and I was also emphasizing on R&D part. So we are a company who love to, go deep into the technology. And this is one of the pitfall if we are, taking this digital transformation and start falling into love with the technology. So affinity to technology is first barrier which we faced in our company. When we were talking about Industry 4 and different technologies such as artificial intelligence, machine learning, robotics, so everything was looking very attractive, but we were not able to move in any direction. Like everything was attractive, but still, no value generation, no outcome, no movement of projects. But we learned by doing analysis that business-centric approach is the key to overcome this barrier or this pitfall. So three things which are important for this business-centric approach. First is this should be an operation-centric approach. So how to optimize the operation? And this optimization is not a lean or Kaizen way of optimization. This optimization is to achieve 10 to 100% times faster speed. Also to generate unlimited capacity. When I say unlimited capacity, it is similar to, in current model, like say if we are executing 10 projects, this is very rough figure, then maybe we require 200 people. And if we need to execute say 50 projects, then we require 500 people. But with the digital or digital transformation, this, capability to execute more projects and the capacity, this has to be delinked somehow. So this is how why I say the capacity unlimited, and to create a cross value thing. This is first operation centric approach. Second is how digitalization is going to open opportunities to business in form of new revenue streams, or how to transform the products and services. Definitely that need to be focused in digital transformation journey. Third is also very important to understand customer pain points and engage customers via digital platforms. And I can see my fellow speaker, he was also emphasizing a lot on their experience by engaging the client. So ultimately we need to learn new ways of solving problems. It will also be a good idea to map the customers and see how they want to deliver their end products either to the industry or maybe for other purposes. So commercials mindset, with very outcome focus and not fall in love with technologies is first secret I can say from my experience for digital transformation journey. Coming to the speed of experiment, you know, when we started our projects, we started with a model of like we were generating idea, then we were running some proof of concept, then we were making a pilot or some prototyping, and then we were rolling it out to production. But it was very slow process, and it was extremely difficult to show value of digital projects to our you know, organizations. And I could also see like in oil and gas industry, we are basically groomed to execute projects in a waterfall project model, where value is getting delivered at the end of a end of the project as a big bang delivery, you can say. There is a risk till you are not able to deliver the product, and also the cost is high in this approach. So like I remember, I think it was 1 year back, for me it was very difficult to explain to senior management when I go and say that that we'll be investing a huge number of engineering hours, and we'll also be procuring some resources from outside, but the benefit organization will be able to see in 3 years time. So it was really a challenge actually. But over a period of time, we learned our project model for digital projects to be agile or incremental development project with a focus on fail fast, also learn, unlearn, and learn cycle. I think this philosophy is very important if oil and gas you know, industry are rolling out digital transformation. We need to definitely unlearn a lot of things which we think we are expert into, you know. So and we also need to divide our projects in phase-wise manner so that each phase can deliver some value to organization. Like we were working on configuration of reactor internal for one of our business stream. So what we did, we launched version one of this reactor internal, and this version one was designed in a way so that you know, the users in the organization were able to utilize this product, and then we built additional feature, and then the version two was launched, and now we are working on version three and version four. So in this way, you know, in a short span of time, we are able to showcase what are the value of the digital products or digital outcomes. So I just want to say from organizations, like they need to think big, but they need to act small, maybe fail fast, but learn from the failures, and you know, and learn rapidly, and again like start this cycle. So this speed of experiment and fail fast and learn, unlearn and learn, this is important aspect of digital transformation. This is again very interesting challenge which we faced actually in our organization, you know. We like conventionally we are you know, the organization is structured like say discipline wise competency, say process engineers in refinery and process engineer in chemical and mechanical, static and piping and instrumentation, electrical, then catalyst and so and so. But what we saw that we are disconnected you know, data, and our data and workflows are totally disconnected. We support, maintain and migrate multiple software version almost constantly, and our total cost of ownership was excessively high. We did initial analysis and found we are having a couple of hundred of you can say in this picture interfaces with you know, with data transfer points, and these data transfer points are a lot of are happening in a manual way. So one entity is generating some data, they are transferring to second entity, then they are doing some processing calculations, then handing you over to next entity. But there are hundreds of interfaces of this data transfer. This is how, when we mapped like what different tools and you know, how the data is transferring, it was a very complex picture, like and it was extremely difficult to understand what exactly is happening. So to get the full potential of digital initiatives or the digital transformation, it is necessary to have you know, this smart platform concept, or maybe a unification of other data across the organization. But to move from this silo approach to the smart platform or industry 4 approach, organization culture can sometime become a biggest barrier. So you need to see what is the organization culture and how much organization is ready to take risk, especially to break the silos which are created from maybe last 50, 60 years in the organization. But my learning was that integrate way of working and finding the right home for digital projects guide to overcome this cultural aspect. And when I say finding the right home, it is very important in digital transformation journey. Like I also remember when we started, you know, rolling out some of the configurator to our organization. So till end of project, everything was very smooth. But then every time question was coming, where is the ownership of these configurator? Who is going to be the owner? Like, I mean to say, like, who is going to own, who is going to maintain to ensure that it is producing the value for which the purpose it has been made. So finding right home is critical for digital transformation. Now our approach is that if there is a chance that a workflow will be needed again, automate it at the first time. Automation helps on many levels. It ensures consistency and facilitates continuous improvement. It also allows transparent tracking and reporting of process status. So most importantly, it allows a company to run many much processes. You know, I also wonder a lot of time, like say we are also making a lot of ammonia plant and hydro treater and hydro cracker design. So why we need to start our design every time from scratch? You know, why don't we pick the design and reuse it? Why don't we have a modularized approach of reusability, which can always give a good results? So when we are moving from silo way of working to industry 4, these questions are coming, and then we are finding a good answer to these questions, and these answers are also becoming part of our digital journey. So this is about silo working to industry 4 and risk averse culture, which is key to success. My fellow speaker emphasized a lot on human factor, but these two pictures, what you are seeing on the screen, I have taken it from homepage of Google and Microsoft, you know, and their homepage, they talk about improving lives of peoples, empowering each person on planet to achieve more. And I personally see this is a key to digital transformation. So when you are rolling it out, digital transformation, it is important to win heart and mind of our colleagues. Otherwise, it cannot be a success. So whole project need to be designed and communicate from a human angle. And when I say human, I also talk about employees, but customers and vendors and rest of the stakeholders which are your interface outside your company. So the ultimate aim should be to make things easy for employees, for customers, and for vendors. This is when we are designing the projects, keeping human angle in mind. But another important aspect is right digital competency and also the right digital mindset. Because right digital competency and right digital mindset accelerates this digital transformation journey. Now the question comes like there can be two, three approaches which can be coming into picture here. Training existing employees, that is one way to build the competency. Second is to hire from outside. So training existing employee can be a longer path or it can take a long time, and hiring can be a costly affair. So somehow it need to be balanced out, these two approaches, while moving in digital transformation. I am not expert in cybersecurity, so I will not talk much about the cybersecurity, but it is critical to address these concerns, which definitely you will see in organization, not only organization, also board of directors, and especially a company like ours, who is a technology driven company, this is a key concern. So this need to be addressed, especially if we are talking about legacy IT systems, and the IT roadmap should be in place to address these concerns. But we were quite lucky or fortunate because we are having progressive IT department, around 70 to 80 colleagues are working. So, and they were covering very well these aspects of cybersecurity, until now, I have shared some of the challenges, like what we faced in our organization, and also some of these steps or the direction we took while moving into the journey. But with the COVID situation, maybe from December 2019, I could see that it is accelerating the digitalization aspect, definitely. Now, work from home is becoming a new normal nowadays. And I could see clearly the consultancy, IT, and a lot of industry, they are able to work. And I feel that the day is not far when our panel operators will also be sitting at home and will able to operate the plant by using digital technology. So we are also using in our company a lot immersive and interactive technologies for inspecting our hardware, for doing catalyst loading, for pre-commissioning and commissioning of the plant. And these digital technologies are becoming a media of daily touch with our own employees and our customers. For our organization, this was possible because we were already having digital platforms and systems were in place. I also see for our production unit, this automation is a clear winner for production and for the supply chain. As traveling is not a disruption to communication nowadays, you can easily talk to your loved one while you are flying. Similarly, greater part of business can operate remotely. And this is what we have learned in a hard way during this COVID-19. So in our organization, we are also, capturing these learnings, and then we are preparing our organization like when situation will become, still how we can utilize these learnings in our day-to-day operation and to interact with our clients. Like in our company, like we initiate the project, we start the project, we develop the concept, we develop feed packages, but then we hand over our feed packages to detail engineering contractors or EPC contractor. Then there is a procurement, vendors, supply chain, construction, and owners and clients are our different, you can say different stakeholder. If we need to build a new refinery or to build a petrochemical plant. But it is important to understand how, how digital ready EPCs are, or how digital ready owners and clients are, or what is happening at vendors and fabricators site, what is happening at supply chain site. If you see total cost to build a refinery, engineering cost is around 20%, construction is 40%, and supply chain is maybe another 40% roughly. But if digital tools are used rightly, then a lot of risk can be mitigated. If we can model, say, the whole thing in a digital world, instead of doing a big mistake at the plant, if we rectify these mistakes in a digital way, simulate whole operation, then we can really achieve the true potential of the digital transformation journey. I would like to end my presentation with one challenge which we cannot do alone. We are definitely becoming digital. We are utilizing the benefit of technology, but we want industry to move along so that we can utilize the full potential during the full life cycle of the plant. Again, I would like to summarize, this is not a function of resource or lack of resource when we talk about digital transformation. It is only a function of drive or lack of drive. So my conclusion is, digital transformation is not an objective, it is a journey, and oil and gas industry is now undergoing this journey. With these words, I would like to end my presentation, and I hand over to ARC team for further proceedings. David, to you.
Okay. Hey, Diamond, thanks very much for your presentation. I really enjoyed it. I reviewed it before today's event, and I was really looking